Christian walk is being shaken.
Well,
all right. But I come to tell you, you're just in a God sent storm.
Well, all right, come on.
It's all right. Amen. We find, amen, in the Gospel of Matthew, the 14th chapter, Jesus had just got through feeding the 5,000. Seemed like, you know, amen, Peter wanted to send them away because he thought, amen, he said, look, we don't have food to feed these people. But look at Jesus. Jesus said, do we have anything to give them? Peter said, the disciples said, look, there's a lad with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. One said, what is that for so many? Jesus said, bring it to me.
All right. Come on, Jesus.
That's important because I'm so thankful that God, mathematics is not my mathematics.
That's all right now. Come
on, God.
Because he took two fish and five loaves of bread and fed 5,000 men. That did not include women and children.
Amen.
And so, seemed like, amen, the disciples should have been ready because God had already demonstrated his power to thee. Amen. This is the way some of us are in our walk with God. Amen. God has brought us out of this and brought us out of that. And seem like when God sends a storm, we want to faint.
Yeah. Well,
somebody say faint.
Faint.
But I'm thankful that God, amen, says bring what you have.
Yeah.
And watch me work.
All right now.
Well, is that all right?
Well,
I may not be able to preach like Paul.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Might not be able to preach like T.D. James, but God said, bring what you have.
Yeah.
Good God Almighty.
Well,
amen. I may not never, the one songwriter said, there are some places I may not go.
Well.
There are some things I do not know. But he said, I am sure of this one thing, that God is real. He's real in my soul. And so you have to stand sure who Christ is. As we go into verse 22, entering into our lesson for today, it said, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitude away.
Well,
that is important because I want you to understand the background of the text, because what was going on here, amen, they was pressing Jesus because Jesus had healed many, raised the dead, opened the eyes of the blind, and they really wanted to make Jesus a king right now.
All right.
This is important because we must understand time and purpose.
That's right. Come on.
But I'm so thankful that Jesus understood time and purpose.
That's right.
It said, and straight away he constrained them, the disciples, to get into the ship. Now, it seemed like, you know Jesus, you got to understand, God is omnipresent. He's omniscient, which means he knows all.
Yes, he does.
You know what I'm saying? He said, get into the ship and go into the other side. He knew they was going to go through a storm.
Uh-huh.
Good God Almighty. How many of you know God? How many of you know sometimes God knows you're going to go through the storm.
Yeah.
And sometimes, amen, he allows you to be in the storm because it's a God-sent storm.
Come on.
Yes. But look, Jesus constrained them. In other words, amen, you're going to have to put forth an effort. Amen. To spend time with God.
All right.
It goes on to say, while he sent the multitude away, and when he had sent the multitude away, he went up into a mountain to do what? Apart to pray.
Yeah.
And so you got to understand, in the time that we live in right now, amen, there must be a press to pray.
All right, now,
it's got to be oppressed to pray. You know, because it was things going on around Jesus. Amen. They wanted to make him king before it was time. Amen. He had healed the sick and raised the dead, and all these things was going on around him. And the disciples, amen, was having conversation. You know, some of them didn't really know who Jesus was, because Jesus said, have you been with me this long and not known me? So all this chaos and commotion was going on around Jesus. So Jesus said, look here, let me send this away. Let me get away. Send the multitude away. Let me send the disciples away and get along with God. Somebody say, get along with God. I'm figuring it out. Amen. A couple years ago, God, amen, brought back to my remembrance. He said, son, you remember the devotional time you used to spend with me. You don't hear me, the prayer, the devotion, the singing hymns. You remember all those times. I said, yes, sir. He said, don't go away from those times, because those things will keep you when everything is being shaken around you. Only your relationship with God. Good God Almighty.
Yes, yes.
So Jesus knew what it was. And so you must remember this. There must be a place to pray.
Oh, yes.
You must have a place to pray. There must be a time to pray.
Yes.
And there must be personal prayer. Somebody say personal.
Personal.
Oh, it's good for me to pray for somebody else. But I heard somebody say, it's me, oh Lord, it's me standing in the need of prayer. Not my mother, not my father, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Jesus had to pray because what he was about to encounter.
Come on.
Oh, see, Lord.
Oh, God.
I find myself telling sometimes younger preachers.
Uh-huh.
I'm just a young man myself. But, amen. I find myself telling them, amen, brother preachers, you're going to have to spend some time alone with the Lord.
There you go.
Yes. Everybody in your ear, amen.
Oh,
don't miss your purpose. Don't miss your seeds.
Yes.
And so you got to spend some time
yes.
along with God.
Yes.
And so Jesus understood that he needed to spend some time along with God.
Uh-huh.
Went on to say in verse 24, but now the ship was now in the midst of the sea.
Yes.
Tossed with waves. Now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Could you imagine the disciples saying, now, Jesus was the one that told us to get in the ship and go to the other side.
Right.
What is he trying to do? Trying to kill us? Good God Almighty. You know how sometimes you know you say, amen, and we heard God.
Yes.
And every time you hear God, does not mean, amen, that it's going to be easy.
Yes. Come on.
Amen. He told the children of Israel, amen, to go into the land, Canaan, go into the land of milk and honey. But when they got there, look, he had already sent the spies out, and some of them brought back a bad report and said, look, there's some giants over there. But guess what? God had said he had still given them the land.
Yes.
And so sometimes, amen, you know, they say, hey, look, we can't take the city. We can't take the city. It's too many giants. It's too many things we got to against us. It's too many giants. And so, amen, sometimes God will tell us, amen, we will hear his voice and we will step out and seem like we will face giants. But I come to tell you that we serve a giant slayer. You got to let the giant slayer rise up in you. And no matter what you're going through, you got to say, God said, I can take the city. I can take the city. I don't care how many churches oversee a ward. It's in Stuttgart. If God say you can take the city, you better believe, baby, you can take the city. I don't care how strong they are, how long they've been in existence. If God said you can take the city, you better gird up your loins with truth. Put on the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, and take in the shield of God, the shield of faith. Good God Almighty. And say, look, giant, you look like Goliath, baby. But guess what? We're going to go to battle up in Stuttgart. I'm going to go down on my knees until I see some deliverance. Good God Almighty. I want to see the blinded eyes open. I want to see people give up crack cocaine. Good God Almighty. I said, come on, giant. Come on, Goliath. I got something for you. I got my B-66. Good God Almighty. It shoots 66 times. If one won't get you, damn it, the other one. Oh, good God Almighty. Sure we. Oh, yeah, yeah, yes. Good God Almighty. Let me move on in this text.